ज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमोम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रस्थाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामीन इति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारणे। श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तरुंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। और भक्तवृंद की जय। हरे कृष्णा एवरीवन, थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग टुडे। आई थिंक वी एज अ पार्ट ऑफ आवर दिस वीकली भगवद गीता क्लासेस, सो टुडे we will start with new chapter, I would say next chapter, which is chapter 5th or chapter 5 from Bhagavad Gita as it is, which is written by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. All right, so before I start, I definitely going to request your blessings. And I pray that the right words and right information comes from my mouth. And if there is any mistake or any correction, definitely I'm looking for your feedback. Okay, Hare Krishna. So with that said, today, as I said, we'll start with chapter 5. And we may not be able to complete chapter 5 in this session. So definitely we will be covering a portion of it today and a remaining portion next Saturday. So that is the plan. So that's what, with that plan, I am going to share my slides and then we'll see what chapter 5 is all about. Okay, so can someone confirm if they see the slides?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay, got it. And my voice is audible, right, Prabhuji?
Yes, Prabhu, yes. Very much.
Okay, great. So chapter 5th, overview, Karma Yoga, Action in Krishna Consciousness. Okay. So let me see. Okay, yeah, all right. So first we will talk about that little word in this whole big group of words. That little word is karma. Okay, so initially we will spend some time on karma, and having that as a foundation, we will then expand on to Karma Yoga, Action in Krishna Consciousness. With that said, we'll go to the next slide. Karma simplified. So we will now go a little deeper what karma is, okay? And there are more information about karma. So karma, in simple word, the action we perform. Action could be, it range from breathing from the nose, walking, talking, going to work, a variety of action one does during a day. And this action not only applicable to human being, but to any living being in this world. Next, which is very important, that I think very, very much relevant for us to understand laws of karma. Laws of karma, which in simple terms, for every cause, there is an effect. So how do we understand in a simple, so this is not a very complicated, of course, at all. This is very simple, but something that will help us understand the next further topics. So I took a very simple example where a girl or a sports girl, she is playing with a ball, where she's throwing a ball against a wall. and the ball comes back. And this something we would say, okay, what is special about it? So we are trying to understand this simple cause and effect concept, where the cause is we throw a ball against a wall, and then the ball hit the wall and it come back. Which meaning there is a cause, which is girl throw the ball, and then the effect is ball after hitting the wall, it come back. So there is, in this example, there is not a situation that ball automatically come back to girl. So there is some cause, there is some action that has happened. With that said, we will now talk about karma phala. Now, who doesn't know the word phala? Phala means another term is fruit or results. So what the phala or fruits I get when I perform karma. So here I would like to take three examples to understand these fruits from our real life. So the first example talk about quick. Quick indicates when action is performed and then one gets the fruits or results or a reaction for that action quickly. Quickly meaning sometime maybe very quickly, like minutes, sometimes could be in hours. So example that I'm taking here is last night this person ate some stale food, and next day morning he is experiencing stomachache. Now this is simple example. However, we can see here the result is the stomachache, and karma he performed is eating stale food. So when I use word quick, which means this is more like over few hours, like 8 hours when he slept, and when he get up next morning, he get a phala, right? Next, I think I said three scenarios. The first scenario is I took quick karma phala. Second is slow karma phala. What is slow means it may not be as quick as the example first that I took. So what that could be? So second example that we see is about a person who is addicted to drinking alcoholic drinks. So initially during young age, as body supports, and he enjoy, but as body ages, say after 20 years, again, don't quote 20 years is always the 20 years, but I just take this as an example. It could be 15, it could be 30. But the point here is after certain, this is a quite a long period as compared to first example. And then he start getting health issue. Could be issue related to kidney, could be issue related to liver, right? So that person experienced the result of his karma, not immediately, not overnight, but after substantial period of time. Again, if you see the example is within same life. I also would like to take example of something from Shastra. This is a real life example. So another example is from Shastra. Now the Shastra, when I say I'm taking example from Ramayana. So if I think most of you probably may know this story, but I'll say quickly. So in Ramayana, Lord Ram's father, King Dashrath, I believe that time King Dashrath may not be even married, but I may be wrong. But in his young age, King Dashrath, when he was, I think, out, he's a Kshatriya. And as a Kshatriya, he used to hunt and say, kill animal in, say, forest. And unknowingly, he thought there is a deer, right? So unknowingly, he shoot an arrow. And that arrow killed Shravan, who is the only child of old parents. So that is a story. But King Dasharatha, and then as a next, immediately what happens is parents, those old parents curse King Dasharatha. What is the curse is? You will also experience, you will experience the same, I would say, separation from your own son, and in that separation you will die. And if you remember the King Dasharatha, he experienced that separation when his son Lord Ram, he went for exile. Okay, so point here is, even though King Dasharatha unknowingly killed Shravan, it was not his intention. Even though it is unknowing act, he get the karma phala. Okay, and then the third example I would like to take, which is a prolonged karma phala, where one get the phala, not even the current life, maybe the same life when the action is performed, but maybe after many, many lives after. That is a prolonged. So in this example, we take example from Shastra, which is Mahabharata. So if you see in the picture, so the example is King Dhritarashtra. He lost all his 100 sons during the fierce battle of Kurukshetra between Kaurava and Pandava. This is we all know. And why, at this point, this is a fruit he experienced of losing all his son, but there was a cause that many lives before, he performed a very bad act of killing birds. And that bad act, the fruit of that bad act, he has to face it, he has to react to it in this particular birth. In the next slide, I'm going to talk about this story in a little bit more detail, exactly how these situations are. But I think this slide, the whole idea is to give an understanding that action one takes, its corresponding fruit or result is bound to come. It will come either quickly, it may come little later, maybe in the same life, or it may come after many, many lives. Okay. So with that said, I'm going to talk about the detailed story of King Dhritarashtra and introduce the point of carry forward. I think you might have heard the word carry forward. Carry forward means, in general terms, say in accounting or when we work in at an employer, sometimes we have certain time off during an year, say 15. But let's say we don't finish all 15, we finish say 10. So the balance 5 you can carry forward to the next year. The same concept, the carry forward. So what carry forward means? So we'll see this, the story of King Dhritarashtra. King Dhritarashtra, 100 life before, he was a hunter. And as a hunter, he was trying to kill a particular bird. But that bird flew away. That made hunter angry. And then as out of that anger, that hunter killed 100 those children of that bird. That's a heinous act he did. Right? Now, for that hunter, right? So that is a bad act. So that's a bad karma he performed of killing 100 children of that bird. So what this means, after that, every birth, So after hunter, there may be some another. So as we have seen in chapter 2, right? The progression of a soul, that soul take another body at the time of a death. The same concept. So that the after hunter leaves the body, another birth. But what is most notable here is baggage of karma. So the baggage of karma you carry forward, whether those are good karma or bad karma, you carry forward. And the time when that karma reaction to fructify or manifest, that varies. In case of this particular story, it takes 100 life or 100 birth. When Dhritarashtra asks this question to Krishna, why I suffered losing 100 kids in this Kaurav Pandav war, why now? Krishna explained this situation and he said, you have to take 100 birth to earn the piety, mean the after performing a bad act of killing 100 small birds, he has to earn the pious credits. The same soul has to go through 100 lives to earn that credit. And why that credit is needed? Because in order for anyone to have a son as a child, if you remember, King Dhritarashtra has 100 sons. To have a son, you need to have some pious credit. And to have 100 sons, you need to have so much of pious credit. So which means after he lived the body of a hunter, over the next 100 lives, whatever the soul is, he definitely collected that pious credit by performing good karma. And that's why in this particular birth, he had 100 sons. So I think what is learning here is we need to understand the baggage of karma. It continues as we move from one body to the next body. And as we continue our journey into repeated cycle of birth and death. So now, if you see here, action of killing 100 bird is like a sowing a seed. Like, you know, farmer, you sow a seed before the rain starts, because you know, when the rain starts, immediately seed will start growing into crops, right? So karma is like same. In this case, hunters, he sow a seed and its seed grows and it takes time. When that soul experiences the reaction, so it takes, that's what the karma phala is. So this soul takes 100 birth and then he experiences that. So we talked about two things. One is law of karma, cause and effect, and carry forward. Now let's talk about next one. Now more laws of karma. Very interesting. Here we see a fire and a baby and adult. When adult put a hand in a fire, that is an action. But what is the karma phala? His hand will get burned immediately. Now, if a baby put the hand, will baby get any like a discount because of a baby? Oh, your hand will not get burned. Only for adult, that is the situation. No. The law of karma is not partial, is not biased, it is universal. The second one, ignorance. I wasn't aware of it. Can I get a waiver? So example is, in our real life, we pay tax. Let's say we are here in US, so we pay tax to US government. If I say, oh, I wasn't aware of paying taxes to government, you know, I didn't pay. You can say that, but it doesn't stop you getting the karma phala. What that means, for example, IRS may come behind you and punish you for a fine, right? So ignorance will not help. No one can escape. The last one, natural calamity. So in Nepal, in 2015, there was a massive earthquake. Many, many people died. However, one six-month baby survived. Again, I didn't put the photograph here. Just I thought to, it was a public news, by the way, but I thought not to put pictures of baby, real time, a real baby. But the point here is, how do we explain, right? So why a baby survive and what not others? So again, laws of karma. Each soul carry his or her own baggage of karma. And when the time come to fructify or manifest, it fructifies. What we see is just our visibility is, we typically see any person, let's say anyone from our family. We see any person in our family, in our neighborhood, maybe from his birth to until death. That is only our visibility. But sometimes that visibility doesn't help us to explain these situations. Now, we understand the karma phala with examples. We understand the laws of nature. Now, understand what that karma phala means to me. Right? Now, we have a knowledge, but where that phala is going to, you know, what is the impact it's going to make? That is something we will see. Okay? So here I took example of good karma and bad karma. Because those are the two big categories that everybody knows. So what good karma are? I took four examples. Again, this is not, don't consider this is the complete list of good karma. I took four just to explain this point. Hospitals, serving patients. Social worker, say who provide free food, clothing to poor people, caring for old age people, help someone in need or distress. These are all good karmas. Bad karma, cheating, hurting, killing or support killing, intoxication, drinking, smoking. These are bad karmas. Now you understand, okay, and again, you probably know these are something that we know already. But what next? Now let's understand the karma phala. Means what is the result? Of course, when you have a good karma, you get good results. When you have a bad karma, you get reactions, sufferings. Again, as I said, the timing for the results, it varies, as we have seen previously. Now what next? So whether you have a good so when you have a good results, what you get, what is the outcome? Of course, you get some pious credit. When you do some good, you get a pious credit. Example is what we see in Dhritarashtra. In order to get even 100 sun, you need to have pious credits. Now satisfy self-desire. Even though those are good karmas, for example, I open a hospital, okay? Or I am serving to some poor people. Even though I'm performing those activity, but somewhere I'm looking for a recognition. I'm looking, even though I'm not asking money from others, but I'm looking for a recognition somewhere in my heart. And when I get a recognition, either by award or either by government, I feel better. So that's where your self-desire starts creeping in. Temporary benefits. So hospital, I serve patient, you cure the disease. That is temporary benefit. Why temporary? You cure the disease. It doesn't mean the patient will not get any more disease throughout for his remaining part of the life. We just cure the current disease. right? Same for serving poor people. We can serve food, clothing, but it will definitely it will help, but it will help to certain limit, right? So that's a temporary benefit, and induced to do more. This point is more relevant to the second point. Meaning, when I get happy with the recognition for the selfless work I do, that make me do more. Meaning, I may open more hospitals, for example, right? Now, all these are good, but we see these are temporary, and somewhere we try to satisfy our inner desire. Meaning, in a way, it is building attachment. There is a Sanskrit word, asakti. Now, where this is going to impact? So, the impact is it eventually get us into repeated birth and death. That we have seen in the previous chapter too. This gets into repeated birth and death. Why? Because we keep hankering for satisfying our self desires. And when those get satisfied, you want to do more. If they are not satisfied, then it gets into anger. Okay, so that anger, kind of pollute your intelligence. And we don't understand what is the real goal of our lives. That is why we get into repeated birth. So these are all connected. Now, having said that, next question is, should I stop doing good karma? That's the big question come to my mind. And does it really help? Next question, does it really help merely performing good karma? First is, should I stop? Because I see just previous slide, right? So let's see what that means. Should we stop doing good karma? Answer is no. If no, then what need to be little different? Change your consciousness in performing karma. What does that mean? I understand changing consciousness. I know changing dress, that is put your old dress and wear a new dress. What does it mean changing your consciousness? Let's see. Change in consciousness. Each living, now this is something how we start looking at surrounding, right? Everybody around us. Usually we have definitely affection and affinity for my own family. And that is where we get more protected. We have more hankering, more attachment. We don't care for more others usually a lot. But when you get each living being is Krishna's family, meaning now you are expanding. You're expanding your vision, not just limited to my family. And when I say each living, it doesn't mean I'm just limiting to human being. Animals, birds, fishes, anybody live underwater, everyone is Krishna's family. And if I consider them as my family member, then I should start loving and caring. That's mean the changing the consciousness. The second one, understand, we see the family, but what next? Knowledge is good, but unless we start applying it, knowledge still knowledge. So that means we need a practice and action. So that's what means the serving. Serve others for eternal happiness and not temporary. What that means, we'll see that in a bit. When we looked at all the benefits in the previous slide, right? Those are temporary benefits. But we'll see what eternal happiness is. How we should serve for the eternal happiness. And that really, that's where the change in consciousness play a big role. I took the same example so that we don't lose the thread. Okay, I'm taking the same example, good karma. I don't want to stop this good karma, performing this good karma, but I want to change the consciousness and still I want to perform those karma. So let's see what that means. Okay. When I say we serve food to poor, I would change it to serving just a food. I would prepare, I cook and serve prasadam. So it's no longer a food. Prasadam, I think if you just, again, I'll repeat, prasadam is something you cook, you offer to Lord, and then whatever you get back, remnant, that is called prasadam. And when such food, when you serve, you are serving two benefits. Number one, of course, hunger is met. And second, you directly get the mercy of Krishna or the Lord. Dual benefit. I think the latter one is bigger because that bring this peace, eternal happiness. That will help slowly to break cycle of birth and death. So that's why this prasadam part is very important. You may say, how it is possible? This is all your belief. Okay, but this definitely helps as per Srila Prabhupada has mentioned and our acharyas has mentioned. So prasadam, when it comes from Lord, has that potency. Second, start sharing the knowledge. I took example of Bhagavad Gita, but Srimad Bhagavatam also. So when we, let's say, for example is when we are serving old age people, even in our home, it doesn't necessarily like old age homes. Wherever you are, you can start talking about it. Maybe read one page. You can read the Bhagavad Gita in respective language. It need not be English. There are many languages you can read. Sorry, my daughter is here. Or it's not working. So read a page. That means we are actually passing the knowledge, which will eventually help to break the cycle of birth and death. Engage them. You explain them the Lord Katha. There are many stories. And most importantly, Harinam, meaning taking the name of Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. So now there are some institutions that do that today. So if you see on the slide left bottom, Bhakti Vedanta Hospital, which is in Mumbai today. They do not just cure patient on the bodily concept, from the body perspective, but they, in the hospital environment, there are continuous Harinam going on. Thus, the nurses, the staff who serve the patient, they also keep reading from the scriptures like Bhagavad Gita. The whole environment is not just a typical hospital, but they also provide the knowledge from these scriptures to the patients. Protect and care for the cows. So that going to each living, right? Each living is Krishna's family. I take example of cows intentionally because cows is very, very, I think, very, very loving to Krishna. And we really should protect every living. It's not just cow, to be honest. Now, in the context of cows, in Pennsylvania, there is a goshala. The name is Gita Nagri, where cows are protected. Cows are taken care of. In typical real life industry, when the cow is old, when cow do not produce milk, cows are not treated well. Cows are killed most of the time. However, in this goshala, cows are treated until they leave the body very nicely. And most importantly, in our ISKCON of Connecticut, we have many of our devotees who take milk every week, which are produced by those cows. Okay, so that is just one example how we can perform those same good karma, but changing our consciousness. that will bring the eternal happiness. Eternal happiness is not really tied to our bodily happiness. It's a happiness related to something we cherish when we experience our true relationship with the Lord. Next one. We talked about two questions, right? Does it really help merely performing good karma? Let's see. There are two questions. Merely performing. What is merely performing mean? You perform and you just expect the result back just for you. That means merely performing. There is no God in the center. Okay, there is no no consciousness for serving others for their eternal happiness. So the question I asked, will it help to repeat, to break that cycle? Will it help to get an eternal peace? But unfortunately, answer is no to both the questions. Now, what is the solution? Now, the solution is this chapter. Chapter 5, Karma Yoga, Action in Krishna Consciousness. So we looked at karma, started with, now where this is leading towards karma, but do your action, but in Krishna consciousness. And let's see how that means as we go forward. Now, as chapter starts, the first question comes from Arjuna with a confusion. Let's see what the confusion is. Which is better? Krishna is asking question. Work in devotion, renunciation of work. Again, we will see what those work in devotion means and renunciation of work really means. But renunciation, as an English term, you are leaving, you're stopping something. So he's saying Krishna, and Arjuna is, I would say, he is really inclined to not to fight. So if Krishna would have said, oh, renunciation is the better solution, Arjuna would be super happy because he really want not to fight. Now, Krishna answers the question like work in devotion is better. And we are going to see what is work and what is work in devotion, what that phrase really means. But I thought to start the chapter with this question, Arjuna is asking. Now we will see what that means. Most importantly, here, if you remember, Arjuna and Krishna right now, they are not talking as a friends. Arjuna has already accepted Krishna as a master, spiritual master. I think in Hindi or Marathi, we say Adhyatmik Guru, because some of these questions, our school books, college books, PhD books will not answer this question. You need a spiritual master. And that's where we see Arjuna is really asking Krishna. What next? He's asking the question in a humble mood. He's not challenging. Oh, no, Krishna, you're wrong. I think renunciation is better. I am going away. No. He's asking the question in a humble mood. And that is the quality. And that's how we should also try to get this knowledge. Okay. So reaching to spiritual guru and asking in humble mood. Very important. That we are learning from this particular conversation. Now, we will take a little bit of, quick, how this question come into even picture, because that will set some better idea. So I took like a little quick snapshot, chapter 1, chapter 2, 3, 4, and now 5. So chapter 1, Arjuna bewildered, not ready to fight. Chapter 2, Krishna start giving knowledge. I am not a body, I am a soul. And how do I break birth death cycle by serving Krishna? Then chapter 3. Now here, most importantly, Arjuna asks question first time. similar question. What is better, intelligence or performing work for results? And then Krishna explain it, like, don't abstain, don't stop working. You have to keep working to perform your duties without attachment to results. And we have seen that in the previous lecture. Then chapter 4 comes, which is all about knowledge, where Krishna guide Arjuna, culminate knowledge. What this knowledge is about? Knowledge is about what is my relationship with the Krishna, and what I should do, right? And how that knowledge we get. Is it just a knowledge like by mental speculation? Somebody write on the paper, somebody wrote in the book, and now we are reading it? No. This knowledge coming through parampara. So this all talks about in 4. Now, if you see here, so when the Arjuna get confused, Krishna says knowledge and again says fight. These are two different, you know, opposite. Knowledge means, I have a knowledge. Okay, so I don't have to perform any action. But Krishna says, no, get up and fight. Oh, that's where the chapter 5 starts. I'm confused. What to do? Fight or just a knowledge? That is, renounce my work and go to a jungle or go to some Himalaya, go to a secluded place, go away from this fighting, live my own life, or work in devotion. What is that? And that's what the context is. Okay. So now, with that as a context, as we see, these are the two broader questions that Arjuna is asking. Should I do renunciation or should I work in devotion? First, we will spend time on this first part, renunciation, today's, and then we will stop and we will continue with the work in devotion in the next Saturday. Okay. So renunciation of work, does it mean stop working? Krishna says work in knowledge. So what that means is, now you have a knowledge. What is the knowledge? Who you really are. I am not a body. I am a soul. Then who is Krishna? Absolute. He is the supreme, or he is a God. Then what is my relation? And what I should do? That is performing karma without attachment to results. So Krishna referred that as a knowledge. Right? So knowledge has the first 4 letters. Know. We should know. Know about whom? Krishna. For example, right? When you have a boyfriend and girlfriend, they love each other. We see that in movies also. But real love is when you know the person. Right? So where Krishna is also helping us, right? Unless you know Krishna, there is little chance you can love Krishna. And love meaning is not just infatuation or singing a song like in Bollywood, right? That love comes from your heart. But Arjuna misunderstood it as inaction. That's Arjuna's part. But we need to understand, practically it is impossible for us to stop working. Not even a second. You can try it at your home also. Not even a second. We perform action every moment. Example is breathing. That we cannot stop. Now, another point even Krishna explains, merely renouncing work externally, will it help? No. Externally mean outside I can see, this person is not really, I'm not doing that activity. But in the heart, you are craving for it. So what is the true knowledge? Is nothing belong to me. All belong to Lord. So here I recently heard one farmer's interview. He is based out of Nashik. So I don't know if you are familiar. In India, the state called Maharashtra. And within Maharashtra state, there is a little, I would say, town, I think. That name of the town is Nashik. And there was a farmer who was doing organic farming. The way he explained, very profound. He said, currently I'm a owner of this land. He said around 2 to 3 acres of land. But this land, before I become owner, someone else was owner. And before that, someone else was owner. And even after I leave my body, someone else become the owner. So there is no true owner of this land. But I will do only my job that, okay, I will just make sure that I produce a nice food, organic food, and I will serve my community. So that understanding that I'm not even a true owner, everything belongs to that one Lord, that is the true renunciation. So that is the true, that profoundly, it touched me. I mean, the way that farmer, the way his thinking is. And most importantly, when Krishna says to Arjuna, if you don't perform your duties, and you said, oh, I want to go, I want to avoid, and it's applicable to every each of us. If you don't perform our duties, prescribed duty, that is sinful activity. So that means stop working or renunciation of work is not a better proposition. So now recap for today. Okay, as I said, this is where we're going to stop. So recap for today. Karma is action. We looked at laws of karma. Cause, for every effect, there is a cause. Karma, laws of karma are not biased. Everybody will get their reactions, whether it's a baby or adult. There is no waiver for ignorance. Oh, I was not aware of it. No, everyone will get if that's applicable. No one can escape. We talked about karma phala, quick, slow, and prolonged. We looked at carry forward. We also looked at merely performing good karma, what it means. And we looked at solution. Karma yoga, action in Krishna consciousness. Right? And we today just looked at the first part, work renunciation. That is renunciating the work. Now, the question is, we understood this knowledge. And I just quickly summarize how it is going to help me. It is just a theoretical knowledge from Bhagavad Gita. I lie, hear it, and just I go away. Now let's see how it's going to help, because Bhagavad Gita really go at a practical level. In English, we say rubber meet the road. This is where the rubber meet the road. Okay. So the first one, understanding why it happened to me. This is a common question we have. When any bad incident, any unfavorable, unexpected event occurs to our life, usually we ask this question, not to everybody, maybe within our heart or in front of God's picture, God deity, God, why it happened to me? I never did wrong to anyone. I was so good to everyone. Why it happened to me? Now, when we understand the laws of karma, slow, quick, slow, prolong, this will help us understand why. Second, prepare us to face karma phala in a right attitude. That will prepare us. If you don't know, then we will complain. We will take some wrong actions. Okay, and that will, as I said, every action we perform is a seed. So every wrong reaction will also become a seed for future. So it prepare us. And the last one, it prepare us from choosing future karma, most important. Because that's where our destiny get changed. I wouldn't say destiny, but your path get changed. It will prepare us from choosing the right actions. And hence, if there is a reaction, yes. But that's where it helps us. So this knowledge is nothing but is a preparations to make sure it bring the maturity and keep us ready. Okay, so I would like to end here. And I think we are ready for now breakout. Damodar Prabhuji, if you are ready for breakout, I will read the question. And then sure, maybe we can regroup again.
Yes.
Is it okay?
Yeah, true. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So the breakout question is, say your son or daughter going to school, and let's say one of your friend, child's friend, or son's or daughter friend, recently moved to apartment from independent house. But there is a reason. because that friend's father financial position collapsed. Maybe he got bankrupt within a short amount of time, and then they had to really leave their independent house, their luxury, even their way of living, you know. And maybe that apartment may be now far away from school, that independent house, everything was nearby, hospital was nearby, school was nearby, whole life is changed, lot of loan on finance, right? The father has a lot of loan. Now your son is also watching, your daughter is watching this situation. Now how you think you will better prepare your child so that she or he can ready, she may not handle it, but she's ready. How can she face this situation if it happens? That's the question. Is it okay, this question?
Yes, bro. Question is fine. Yeah, bro. And if anyone has any questions related to what Prabhuji said before, they can ask their questions also now. We can just take one question, one or two questions, and then we can break out.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll move to breakout. Rasraj Prabhu, can you divide us into two groups? Wonderful class, Prabhuji. Very simplistically explained about karma and bringing from all the way from A to Z, you brought it, how the cycle of karma works. It is one of the most complex things to understand. Rasraj, can you divide us into two groups, please?
Yes, bro.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hi, I just joined. The breakout room started. This Arnab here.
Yes.
Okay.
You want to join in the breakout?
Yeah, please.
But 3 to 4 she played, because she played without playing with me.